now with the latest of his biographies of leading political figures, Michael Cockerell presents this intimate film portrait of Labour's last premier.
Those days, Jim Callaghan.
Yeah. Jim Callaghan was Labour's last prime minister. Neil Kinnock was the guest of honour before the election campaign began last month at Lord Callaghan's 80th birthday party.
Now, there's a beautiful coincidence about this because it is 30 years to the month that I met Jim Callaghan first. He came along with the first secretary of the Soviet embassy and the Israeli embassy and the American embassy. Yes. To the Student Socialist Society in the University College in Cardiff. Next week's expose in the Sunday Times will, I'm certain, give an honourable mention to Jim Callaghan.
Clever, I was probably. A lot of people say I'm not clever at all, and I quite prefer to accept that, except that I became Prime Minister and they didn't, all these clever people.
Farming is Jim Callaghan's main interest outside politics. On his Sussex farm, pregnant sheep are scanned electronically to see how many lambs they're going to have. Callaghan is the only man ever to have held the four highest offices of state: Chancellor, Home Secretary, Foreign Secretary and Prime Minister. He feels that a politician can learn a great deal from farming.
She's an old grandma. She's been with us for years, that girl. This wonderful machine tells you whether you've got singles, twins, triplets or even four. I hope never to have four. But three we don't care so much for. We soon have twins.
I hope never to have four.
Oh, well, because a poor you can't really feed four. And she's only got two teats after all, so she can really only feed two.
Single in the middle.
Single in the middle.
Yeah. Actually, see the amber lightning cord? It's like a sausage actually going.
See that sausage?
Oh, yes,
thing?
Yes,
that's,
yes.
It's actually joined onto the lamb there.
Oh, that's the umbilical cord,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Well, I'm going.
That's interesting, isn't it? 42. Enjoy it.
I enjoy it very much. And you. There's a wonderful feeling when you come out in this barn late on a March night and you deliver a couple of lambs. I can see one there. There is literally one standing there now that I delivered. I know because she's got a black patch over her left eye, and I remember coming in here late at night and delivering that one. And of course you get a tremendous sense of satisfaction out of that, you know, doing something like, especially when you're in politics, you know, and you're dealing with a lot of intangible things, and in politics you don't always see the end of what you're doing. You rarely see the end of what you start out to do. If you've been Chancellor of the Exchequer, oh, you don't see any achievement there. All you see are curses and swearing.
There are millions of workers in this country who will never get fair play until you've got a decent incomes policy. Can't you get that into your head?
Well, I've no idea what that was about, I must say. But in those days, you either had a serious, earnest inquirer like that who was so overcome with emotions, you determined to go on heckling unless you could quieten it down and promise her a fair hearing, or you had good-humoured heckling by individuals. That was fine. I loved that. I mean, I enjoyed the riposte and the engaging of people, and of course you always tried to get the audience on your side. The audience always wanted fair play.
You come down here and ask that question. Will you give her a bit of time?
I think it's a hurry.
Yeah.
The Labour lovers asked him to go to St. Vincent de Paul School.
Yes.
And those that voted for him in the last election,
yes.
He came to the school, he said he was going to do this, and he was going to do that. He never done a thing. And the Labour mother was thoroughly disgusted when I had to fetch our own Tory man, who wasn't in Parliament anymore, to take the can back for Mr. Perry, which she never done.
Well, now, look, the lady has asked a question in a perfectly fair way. It is a local question about the Mr. Perry and the local schools. Now, what I'm going to say to you, dear, is this. If you'll listen to me a moment,
yes.
Mr. Perry will be glad to answer that question when I finish. Now, would you like to stay and sit down quietly until I finish? That's a good girl. Thank you very much.
Slightly familiar. I hope she didn't mind, but in those days you could call someone dear without being accused of being sexist. Well, what strikes me about seeing these clips is that how much more natural meetings were then than they are now. I mean, we didn't bus in lots of supporters and have ticket meetings because you didn't need to. The leaders didn't have to be so stylized. They didn't have to be wrapped up in paper and kept away from the public. It was a lovely interchange you had with the public in those days, and I very much regret the change. I'm so glad I don't have to do it. I don't think I could be parceled and tied up in string and told to do all the things by cameramen and public relations advisors and the rest of it that people seem to have to do now.
Callaghan was not a son of the traditional ruling classes. Born in Portsmouth in 1912, his father was a naval petty officer who was away at sea during Callaghan's boyhood in the First World War. His mother was one of the two formative influences on his early life. The other was the Portsmouth Baptist Chapel.
First hymn is a prayer for patience.
I went to Sunday school twice on Sunday and to chapel twice on Sunday. It was a strict religious home.
Number 612.
We had a Bible reading every morning after breakfast. My mother was an evangelical Christian, a strict woman who I think didn't easily show her affection for us. She believed in the second coming of the Lord, preferably and hopefully in her lifetime. And this was imbued in me too. And that only those, I somehow envisaged, that I imagined that I was told that only those who were worthy would go to heaven. And I imagined that somehow when the Lord came, we would all rise. We would literally ascend to heaven. And I came home from school one day during the war. I could only have been about 6 or 7, I suppose. And I walked into the house. And I called for my mother, and there was no reply, and I went round the house, and there was no one there. And it suddenly dawned on me that the Lord had come, and that I'd been left behind because I was such a guilty, bad boy. Eh? Terrible thing, isn't it, for a child to have that sort of feeling when he was 6 or 7. Thank heaven she then appeared, so everything was all right. I decided I'd been given a reprieve. All those little things went on. I used to say my prayers every night at her knee, always had the same prayer. I suppose I could remember it now.
What was it?
Well, I remember how it finished, you know, the usual thing. Of course, my father was away at sea and in the war and so on, it was always that. And then I used to sing a little hymn at the end, a verse of a hymn. Lord, keep us safe this night, secure from all our fears. May angels guard us while we sleep till morning light appears.
Callaghan lived in a series of Portsmouth boarding houses with his mother after his father had died from war wounds in 1921 when Callaghan was only 9.
I think I was a good little boy at one stage, and then after my father died, and whether a psychiatrist would find a connection, I don't know. I think I became a rather naughty little boy. Certainly a lazy little boy. I didn't do any work at school. I didn't keep out of trouble. I used to get into trouble, term after term. I know my mother used to say, you're going to become an errand boy. This was the worst thing that could be said. She, of course, had to fill my father's place. Because as my mother didn't have a pension, I won't say food was sparse, but it was certainly not, wasn't a gourmet's diet. it really was very often just bread and dripping and a cup of cocoa made with water, not with milk. Of course, we had to go home in those days to dinner. There weren't any school dinners, and we went to and fro four times. That was really quite an experience that, again, I've remembered throughout my life. And I hope, I know sometimes I can be short-tempered, I hope I've never been short with poor people who can't help themselves. If I tend to be short with people, it's with people like yourself who can stand on their own feet and can argue and fight back.
But it could have been, it was, I remember, quite intimidating when you, with one of the great officers of state that you held, was absolutely furious and let fly, and of course working for the BBC.
That I find very hard to believe. I never feel that people can be intimidated with me. How can that happen? I'm such a jolly, cheerful sort of fellow that I don't. Audrey tells me that sometimes when I'm totally unconscious of it, that I intimidate people. When I really don't intend to and don't mean to. And I'm very sorry about it. I can't explain it.
Callaghan first met his wife Audrey more than 60 years ago. He'd left his Portsmouth secondary school at the age of 17 and moved to work as a tax clerk at Maidstone in Kent. She lived in a village outside the town, the daughter of a middle-class family. But like the young Callaghan, she was a Sunday school teacher in the Maidstone Baptist Chapel.
And that was the way I met Audrey. I'd only been there a fortnight, and I went down to Sunday school. And this tall, slim, 16-year-old grammar school girl, wearing her grammar school hat, and looking quite unlike any other girl I'd ever seen in my life, came up to me and uttered the immortal words, "Mrs. Borman is expecting you to tea this afternoon." I remember that. And she was, I thought, what a wonderful, lovely girl she is, you see. I didn't know who she was. And that was how we met. I was 17, she was 16. And now, here we are. She's still putting up with me after all these years.
Too much for you to kiss goodbye.
Not at all. I'd love to.
All right.
Yes, fine.
There we are.
No, what? I never do it three times a day.
Callaghan married in 1938, and he says that Audrey brought an element of middle-class stability into his life. He'd left the Inland Revenue to become Assistant Secretary of the Tax Officers' Trade Union. He was a Labour supporter, partly because Ramsay MacDonald's Labour government had given his mother a pension. She had encouraged him to become a tax clerk because it was a pensionable job, but it was not one that he enjoyed.
I'm very much ashamed now. I really was a very brash young man and probably a very troublesome young man.
But a lot of people might think a clerk in the Inland Revenue was a pretty boring sort of job.
Oh, I thought it was a very boring sort of job. I got out as quickly as I could, despite my mother's protestations. There I was, throwing away at the age of 20-something or other the possibility of a pension at 60. What could I be thinking of? The stupid boy I was. But I was very happy to leave. I left for almost anything, I think. You realise, of course, that I left in order to take up a trade union job, but that was where my conviction lay.
In the Tax Officers' Union, Callaghan learnt a negotiating maxim he was to apply throughout his career. Remember, he was told, more flies are caught with honey than with vinegar. In the Second World War, Callaghan followed his father into the Navy. He began as an ordinary seaman in the patrol service.
We sailed to Iceland. I remember we used to have old 303 rifles, and when we saw mines, we used to try to shoot the eyes off them, you know, to see if we could get them to explode. And of course,
did it succeed?
Yes, sometimes. Now, I wasn't very good at it, but the captain was. It might be good. But the chief thing was the weather. It was ghastly sometimes between the north of Scotland and Iceland, as you hear on the weather forecast regularly. And I remember how the young sailors, I regard as rather older, of course, but I was still an ordinary seaman, they used to tie a rope bucket round their necks when we were out at sea, so they could be sick in it and at the same time carry on and do their jobs.
Callaghan proved to be officer material and was promoted to lieutenant. His ambition now was to become a politician when the war was over. Wearing his naval officer's uniform, he'd impressed the selection committee and was adopted as the Labour candidate for Cardiff South. And he first fought the seat in the 1945 general election.
We had a very happy campaign, and the morale of the Conservatives was very low. They had a candidate who, well, a member, Colonel Sir Arthur Evans, who'd been there for many years, 20-odd years. Anyway, he had a lady friend in Penarth, and our lads used to appear on the platform with him, you see. He was married, this lady friend used to appear on the platform, and our lads used to go to stand in the back, and when he got up to speak, they used to start, "Hello, hello, who's your lady friend? Who's the little girlie by your side?" Poor Arthur Evans, he didn't have a chance.
Here is the state of parties up to 3 o'clock in detail. Conservatives, 180. Labour, 364.
In the Labour landslide of 1945, Callaghan won the Cardiff seat that he was to hold for the next 42 years.
Oh, yes, indeed. Greatest experience in my life up to that moment, and to become a Member of Parliament and to enter Parliament and to go into the Chamber as of right, because you've been elected. There could be nothing that anybody could offer you that would be more valuable than that. I must say, our leaders must have thought, what on earth have we got here? 300 raw, new, young members of parliament, many of them back from the war and the forces, had to be licked into shape and whipped, you know, into some sort of lobby and the rest of it. Herbert Morrison must have looked down on us from the platform with that one eye of his and thought, what on earth am I going to do with this lot? Eh? And it must have been a very trying ordeal for a new government, having to face everything else, to also to handle we lot. But there was very high morale, you see, for the first couple of years. We were going to build a new Britain. We were going to make sure there wasn't unemployment. We were going to have the houses. People were going to be at work. We were going to create a health service. And all this was coming to pass. And we used to stay cheerfully late at night then. And we would sing our way through the lobbies.
In 1946, Callaghan went on a delegation to the Soviet Union. At the time, he was seen as a left-winger.
The Russian people is determined on world peace, and they think one of the best ways they can get it is by clearing fascists out of every hole and corner, and that includes people like Mosley and General Franco.
At Westminster, the Chancellor, Hugh Dalton, had noted in his diary, "Callaghan is remorselessly ambitious and very able." The patrician Dalton enjoyed talent spotting among young backbenchers.
The first thing he did was to talk to you, which was really and quite unusual. I mean, you know, cabinet ministers didn't on the whole in those days talk very much to backbenchers, certainly not young backbenchers, might have talked to their own colleagues. But that was the first thing he did. He used to like the company. Secondly, he would give you a question to ask. Thirdly, he would refer to you if he was speaking in the House. As my honourable friend, the member for Cardiff South, said in what was a splendid speech that I'm sure was listened to with appreciation by every member of the House. Well, you sat up there, you thought, well, that's rather good, you see. But this was Dalton, and he genuinely liked to help young people.
This is pedestrian crossing week.
With the help of Dalton's patronage, after only 2 years in Parliament, Callaghan had taken his first step up the ministerial ladder. He'd been made a junior transport minister.
Outside the Houses of Parliament, television's Mary Malcolm asked Mr. James Callaghan MP, parliamentary secretary to the Ministry of Transport, what pedestrian crossing week means.
I understand that this week we're having a pedestrian crossing week. Now, why?
Well, there's an awful lot of young people grown up since we were using crossings before the war, and I think a lot of people have forgotten about them since the war. And we think it would be a jolly good idea to really remind people of their use to everybody.
Well, I think that's a splendid idea.
Well, that's extraordinary. That's 45 years ago. What a good-looking chap he was, wasn't he, eh? And you notice her hat, too. That's slightly odd. Some people are very self-conscious in front of the camera. I don't think I've ever really been self-conscious about it, because I never even bothered to think about it. I think about what you're talking to me about, and then I answer.
In the news, a fortnightly discussion among speakers of different political views on topics in the news.
Callaghan became a star of the early TV programmes, One critic praised his chin-thrusting fluency. But after Labour lost office in 1951, Callaghan used the 13 years in opposition to build up his own power base in the party through his close contacts with the trades unions. Though he sought to maintain lines to both left and right during the bitter feuds that split the party in the 50s, he was deemed too moderate by left-wing constituency activists.
They want people who are extremely militant, extremely radical, who want to be pushing on the whole time. I'm a rather more cautious type of chap than that. I've got to carry a very heavy responsibility, maybe, in the next government.
The next Labour government came in 1964, when Harold Wilson won the cliff-hanging election with a majority of 4 seats. Wilson summoned his shadow chancellor, Jim Callaghan, to Downing Street.
The taxi cab deposited me at number 10, and I must say then I behaved in a slightly emotional way. I threw my arms round Harold Wilson. He must have wondered what had happened to me. And his reply was to disengage himself and say to me, "I've been waiting for you. Where have you been? I want to announce at 8 o'clock, that was in a few minutes' time, the new members of the cabinet, and I hadn't seen you." I said, "Well, I'm awfully sorry." He said, "But you're going to be Chancellor of the Exchequer, aren't you?" Well, it was, of course, a great ambition for me, and I was delighted to say yes immediately, and it was announced. As I walked out, a very urbane figure glided from the intervening door to number 11 towards me and said in a silky voice, "My name is Ian Bancroft, and I am your private secretary. The permanent secretary is in number 11, and he would be very happy to see you if you would care to come through." It was all said in tones of the utmost politeness, and yet a clear indication that if I didn't go, they wouldn't think much of me. So I went next door and was immediately sat down in the Chancellor's chair in the study there. And on the table, in the middle of a blank sheet of blotting paper, was a huge document which was about as thick as this, literally as thick as this, in foolscap, all beautifully typed. And it was a brief that the Treasury had prepared during the election period. And to read that was like throwing a bucket of cold water over me, because I realized for the first time that the figures we've been working on about the balance of payments were really quite out of date, and not only out of date, but we'd underestimated them very seriously.
Good evening. I'd like to tell you about the position I face as Chancellor of the Exchequer. First of all, I've got, hanging like an albatross around my neck, a rather dreadful overseas deficit that must be cleared off. And the sooner we can clear it off, the better.
At a secret meeting on Callaghan's first full day as Chancellor, he and Harold Wilson took the fateful decision that was to overshadow his whole time at the Treasury. They decided not to devalue the pound. But Callaghan emerged radiating bonhomie, despite the record balance of payments deficit he'd discovered.
We've been discussing the economic situation. We've been working very hard, yes.
What have you actually been doing this morning?
Working, all right. Working, we're working this afternoon, and we're working tonight, and we're working tomorrow.
We had that meeting to decide that we would not devalue at that moment, so it was a very fateful occasion, but as always, I tried with the cameras there to put on a cheerful mien and not to look as though I was disturbed.
Why did you do that?
Oh, because of confidence. Sometimes my private secretary during the dog days of the Treasury would say to me, "Chancellor, why don't you walk down the corridors of the House and talk to people and show them just how confident they are, you are?" And I said, "Ian, do you really want me to show how miserable I'm feeling?" He said, "No, but you don't do that. You reassure people when you see them and talk to them." So I would immediately trot off down the corridor and talk to a few people, and then the rumour would get around, "Chancellor doesn't seem to be awfully worried. Perhaps it's better than we think."
See, you're a canny fellow, that Callaghan.
Any chap who's an Englishman with an Irish name who represents a Welsh seat must be a canny chap.
But within a month of becoming Chancellor, Callaghan faced his first sterling crisis when the city gave the thumbs down to his emergency budget. Faced with a violent run on the pound, Callaghan fell apart under pressure, according to some of his cabinet colleagues. One account came from George Wigg, Harold Wilson's confidant and the paymaster general based at No. 10.
His hands trembled and his lips quivered, and that one felt sorry for him. He didn't know what hit him.
I think the last thing is true, that I didn't know what had hit me. I hope my lips weren't quivering or my hand wasn't shaking. I very much doubt that. But the plain truth is, because of the prejudices of the city about the Labour Party, the Labour government always has to do rather more than the Conservatives do in order to reconcile that, in order to reconcile the stupidities of the city.
But Callaghan recovered his nerve, and the first tax clerk to become Chancellor set about wholesale reform of the tax system. The capital gains and corporation taxes he introduced are still in place, but his selective employment tax came under fierce attack and was killed off. Callaghan's redistributive approach made him a hate figure for the Tories.
But Mr. Callaghan suffers from what I hope you will regard as a fatal defect in a Chancellor. He's always wrong. Not just sometimes. But Jim Callaghan, the laws of averages have been suspended.
Did you have any doubts about your ability to fulfil the role of Chancellor of the Exchequer?
Not when I began, only when I finished.
Really?
Well, of course, the problems of the British economy were such that no Chancellor of the Exchequer could expect to cure them, nor has any Chancellor of the Exchequer before or since done so.
Roy Jenkins, describing your time as Chancellor, said that you always looked potentially vulnerable in that office, not exactly fragile, but more like a large guardsman who might suddenly come crushing down at the ceremonial parade.
Well, that was what happened, wasn't it, when Sterling went, because I was always aware of the weakness of Sterling, and it was something that lived with you the whole time.
The forward market is quite erratic today, so chaotic conditions here. There's 68, 63.
In November 1967, after 3 years of trying to prop up the ailing pound, the pressure on Sterling became irresistible. The government was forced to devalue.